Good morning. I'm delighted to welcome you to UU Santa Fe this morning, both of those of you who are here in the room and those of you who are at home online. My name is Sandy Prinz. I'm sharing the worship associate role this morning with Brian Fredrickson, and I use the pronouns she and her. Our special guest this morning is Reverend Len Schriener, a colleague of Reverend Gail Mariner's on the Interfaith Leadership Alliance. Len is an ecumenical Catholic priest and the author of A Soul's Journey into Interspiritual Space, which is at the base here, and there are more copies out in the foyer for later. Len has worked in interfaith and peace and justice campaigns since 1983. And is a guitarist and singer who will lead our final song today. Also participating in today's service are Lydia Madrick as pianist and Del Wilkinson as song leader. We are also grateful to the tech team, to Jill Fredrickson for the flower arrangement, to the greeters and the office staff, and for all they do to make this morning happen. Welcome. The opening words this morning are by Tess Baumberger. Did you want to get closer? Or? This place would be less beautiful without you. Muslim, Christian, Buddhist, Jew, Hindu, humanist, and earth-centered too.
This place would be less beautiful without you. Your heart honed by hardship, grief, illness, seeking solace and comfort here among us.
This place would be less beautiful without you, filled with joy and gratitude, seeking celebration of life's bounty.
This place would be less beautiful without you, curious, inquisitive, asking questions, seeking transformation, emerging from within.
This place would be less beautiful without you, striving to resist a world that tells us we are so much less than we can truly be.
This place would be less beautiful without each of us, born here in this morning to seek heaven's fire in each other's souls, our own flames rising to meet. Our chalice lighting words this morning are from Reverend David Breeden. We unite in our differences in background and belief. We unite with gratitude and hope. Hope for a world of differences. Hope for a world that honors difference. We unite in community with gratitude for differences.
The story this morning is called God Has Many Names, adapted from Marianne Moore's book, Hide and Seek with God. Once upon a time, a girl and boy played with each other and argued with each other. Sometimes they argued about who could swing the highest, and sometimes they argued about whose cookie was the biggest. One time, though, they were arguing about God's real name. God's real name is Mother of Us All.
No, it isn't. God's real name is Father in Heaven.
No, it's Mother.
It is not. It's Father.
I have an idea. Let's go find God and ask her what her name is, and then we'll know for sure that you'll see that I'm right.
Okay. I think that's a very good idea, because when we find God, He will tell you that His real name is Father.
So they went off to find God. Even though both of them admitted they were a bit afraid to go too far from home, and they might be a little afraid to talk to God. After they had gone some distance, they met people carrying food home from the market, and they said, "We are looking for God, so we can find out God's real name." One of the women said, "I think if you go straight down that road, you will find God, but I can tell you that God's real name is the Giver of Life." They thanked the woman, but they said they needed to ask God themselves. She gave them some bread and fruit for their travels. They continued down the road until they came to a river where people were fishing from a boat. When they asked where they could find God, one of the fishermen said, "You'll have to cross the river to find God, but you don't really need to cross because God's real name is the Hidden One." But the boy and girl said they needed to ask God themselves. So they crossed the river and ran into other people along the way who had different names for God. One group told them to go deeper into the forest to find God, but that God's real name was Protector. When the boy and girl said they needed to find God for themselves, the people wished them well and gave them some blankets for the journey. Night came. The girl and boy ate the bread and fruit and covered themselves with the blankets for warmth, and they fell asleep. When morning came, just as the sun was peeping through the trees, they heard a kindly voice say,
"I understand that there are children here who want to know my real name."
That's right.
We do.
"Well, what do you think my real name is?"
"I think your real name is Mother of All."
"And so it is."
"See, I was right."
"Well, I thought it was Father in Heaven."
"And so it is."
"See, I was right."
"Hey, wait a minute. How can we both be right? And what about the people on our trip who said your name was Giver of Life and Hidden One and Protector? What about them?"
"They are right too. I have many names. Some people say I have 99 names. Some people say I have thousands of names."
"What are some of those 99 names?"
"Well, Giver of Life, Hidden One, and Protector are three of them. Others are Truth, the Creator, the Loving One, and the 100th name is Allah."
"What are some of the thousands of names?"
"Mother of All, Father in Heaven, Shiva, the Great Spirit, Gaia. Any of these names is my real name if the person who calls me it does so with a loving heart."
"Well, my heart feels loving when I call you Mother of All."
"And my heart feels loving when I call you Father in Heaven."
"Then Mother of All is my real name for you, and Father in Heaven is my real name for you."
And the girl and boy thanked God for helping them to understand. As they went home, they argued about who had been the bravest. But they didn't argue anymore about God's real name.
Well, it's a pleasure to be here this morning. I was telling Sandy, one of the first people I met when I came here in 2018, that is the Santa Fe area, was Gail. And we've been friends and in the Interfaith Alliance together ever since. She invited me today to share a little bit from my book, A Soul's Journey into Interspiritual Space. And I will, from 257 pages, how can I summarize? I'll hit some high points. When I was growing up as a farm boy in western Kansas, the youngest son in a very Roman Catholic family, for my family and I, there was really only one way of understanding who God might be. The God with one name, sometimes referred to as three persons in one. God was Roman Catholic, Jesus was a Christian, and the Holy Spirit was a dove whom we could not see, was flying around somewhere. My homily today is about the journey of moving from a very limited consciousness toward a spiritual cosmic consciousness. My story is not unique or special. In fact, it parallels the journey so many others have made, and I believe today even thousands, maybe millions, are making in this century. Jean Houston wrote, "Most of us will log 5 to 50 times the experience of our ancestors of 200 years ago. Many of them received at birth," she says, "the pattern for their lives, growing up to be a farmer, a weaver, a soldier, a parent, a priest. In my life, as a young person, becoming a priest was the sole focus from age 14 till 26. And after 12 years in seminary formation, at last I was ordained a baby priest. I smile now remembering how I felt as if I had reached some pinnacle and that I was truly extraordinary and I believed my life was now settled. I would have a safe, secure, respected career, work hard, move straight ahead, and never look back again. All of this was a case of inflation. I was high, that was my excuse, living in Denver, Colorado, it's easy to do. I was high on my self-image. Later, as I grew, I began to realize I possessed a self-image and I was someone with a very limited human consciousness. Thankfully, slowly the air began to go out of my balloon, and I would replace my early lenses, the way I saw everything, with deep seeing. I'm still working on that. That's a concept from Thich Nhat Hanh. But first I had to be awakened. My soul's journey was a gradual and gracious awakening, with thanks to how gentle and compassionate, another name, the divine lover, was to my sensitive and idealistic heart. The first wrinkle, I had it all figured out in my perfect map for a perfect ideal life, came when I was a young pastor, 33 years old, and the first time I began to ask myself, this is from my book, whether my insular provincial worldview was true. Somehow I got caught up in the scent of a wider world, one with a breath 100 times greater than the comforting sound and smells of home. In those days, I began immersed in a series of economic and peace protests carried out with interfaith sisters and brothers in Denver. Privately, in my habit of being an avid reader and a curious explorer of world religions, I wrote, strange spiritual figures and teachers and authors crossed my path just long enough to point me down unfamiliar pathways, which I admit with a smile were often of the delicious and daring variety. Now I'm leapfrogging forward into the 1990s. I'm now in Seattle, Washington. In the summer of 91, I attended a peace conference on the Olympic Peninsula. Maybe some of you have been there or seen it. And now an even more sweet and unexpected opening in my limited consciousness occurred. Thank God. At a morning meditation, sitting in a circle of strangers from a variety of different denominations and religions, I felt a oneness with virtual strangers on some deep, unspoken level. I can remember it as if it was yesterday. I had no words for this union. I was there in that circle because I was honoring my soul's unspoken, unformed yearnings. This was my first experience of what I would call today spiritual spaciousness, an underlying unity that ran deeper than all the customary venerable words sacred to our sacred traditions, an encounter when our roles and our religions and public identities slipped into the background. I remember that morning, I was stunned and injected with a stream of hope that has never left me. Unconditional love permeated me. Perhaps that's another term for God. So in preparing to be with you today, I promise to say something about the conditioning that I see that shapes most or all of us, and that shapes our religions, that acts as barriers and roadblocks between good people, acts mostly in our unconsciousness and prevents us, in the words of Paul from his writings, from becoming that full humanity which has come to full stature. So here I am today to wonder with you, why is it that this process of evolution, or we use the word transformation, takes so long? Maybe you've asked yourself, and is often so gradual, the proverbial pattern of two steps forward, one step backward, goes on and on. In the 1980s, still knee-deep in Catholic culture, I began to redefine what I understood as faith, and to give it this shape. The change was from what I grew up with, a conviction about certain set of precepts and teachings. I was a star with the Catholic catechism. Keeping the faith, as my seminary teachers and family and Catholic culture would have me do, meant that when in 1989, from Denver, I chose to leave my beloved Franciscan order and exit the Roman Catholic priesthood, I was viewed by some of them as someone who had lost his faith. But in fact, in the internal, explosive, and revolutionary inner experience I was having, I was reimagining what is finally true and what I would entrust my life to. Equally important, I had rediscovered through my inner spiritual teachers, faith is not possessed by one group of believers, but is a human phenomena, a fundamental part of human consciousness that appears in many forms. What an eye-opener that was for me. I eventually adopted the description of faith given by Thomas Keating, the Trappist monk, who at the time lived in Snowmass, Colorado, high in the mountains, a few hours from Denver, where I lived. Keating said, faith, I love this, faith is an opening, surrendering, and responding to ultimate reality. This relationship precedes any belief system. Now, I don't want to paint too rosy of a picture and say that in this transition or transformation of many years, all was well. Moving from my narrow Roman Catholic environment, moving into interfaith friendships, moving into the international space of world religions was for me a gradual, much larger, slow story. I passed through many doors on this spiritual adventure, and there was much what I call spiritual dissonance. You've heard of cognitive dissonance, inner conflicts and confusion along the way. To answer the question I am proposing here, why is there a dynamic force that keeps people of faith at a distance from one another? What is the resistance? Part of the answer, I think, is we all participate in an unconscious way in what Carl Jung called the collective unconsciousness. So there's a handout there. At the top left-hand corner, there's a trilemma. And what that's describing is being caught in this collective unconsciousness. I don't think I have the word there, but that's what I'm describing, and putting other identifiers there. We ingest and inherit and certainly internalize so many unconscious assumptions. This is a working definition of the collective unconscious: notions, beliefs, truth, ideas, and attitudes from all that has gone before us, all the way back. Jung put it this way: the collective unconscious consists of elements of the human species. The collective unconscious contains the whole spiritual heritage of humanity's evolution, born anew in the brain structure of every individual. And then the Jungians say it is through these patterns that the drama of our own life has to pass through, the many doors or windows or passages. The collective unconscious includes all the instincts and impulses that take the form of behaviors and go on without conscious motivation. That's, they behave as instincts almost. Simply put, they are inherited, in his terms, archetypes that occur uniformly and regularly. Someone fits the archetype of the wise person, the priest, the farmer, the scientist down the line. In those moments when we are completely honest with ourselves, we realize we can no longer say to others with a straight face, I have no racism in me, or I love everybody unconditionally, or say, everyone's life is as important to me as my family's, as my nationality, and my religion, and my own safety and welfare. Now, I give that example not for self-condemnation, but rather as an opportunity to think about our greater self and greater self-awareness, and to recognize the shadow, which is so related to the collective unconscious. Instincts, impulses, attitudes that are buried so deep. I found out how racist I was on a basketball court when I was a white man with a number of blacks. And I said, boy, just like that. And then I wanted to run because these guys were all bigger than me. So take a look at the handout. It has some description on the left of the trilemma, I think, that the religions have been in within this concept of Jung. And then we'll talk more in a little bit about the right-hand side, the more positive and hopeful. The very names of God, when clung to like gods or gold, can keep us divided. But as we might have sensed with the story of the children asking sincere questions about God's name, like Jesus said once, to enter the kingdom of God, let's think of it, my friends, not as a place or a church or heaven. To enter the kingdom of God, the great story, he said, you must become like little children again. Open, curious, not so full of settled and locked down thought forms or opinions or worldviews, still growing, still exploring. We got the spirit of that in that reading, still changing day by day. Or as Jesus is reported to have said in the Gospel of Thomas, when asked, when is the kingdom of God coming? Again, the great story. He answered, the kingdom of God is not coming in an easily observable manner. Some will say, it's over there. Others say, no, it's over there at UU or the cathedral. Rather, the kingdom of God is spread out over the earth and people aren't aware of it. So it's difficult to see what is subtle and what is present when your attention, as mine was in the beginning of my story, so focused on a particular thing, my personal story, or the larger story of my tribe, my nationality, my ethnicity, my religious group, and therefore missing the great story. Because of conditioning, of course, so I don't have to be self-condemnatory, but I can realize it, that there's something larger that leads us to the kingdom of God, or I like to call it the beloved community. We'll come back to that in a little bit.
We have three stones of conscience in the bowl by the chalice. The mountain stone reminds us that we are worshiping on land that is the ancestral home of tribal peoples, and that we have made a commitment to work in community with others to redress the tragedies and harms created by colonialism and privilege. The geode reminds us of our commitment to work for peace in the world, a world where the violence of wars and hatred continue to escalate in all parts of the planet. Our hearts grieve for the millions of people afflicted. The small water wash stone represents our commitment to learn and practice better ways to care for and enhance the regeneration of our natural world and to reduce our contributions to climate change. May we courageously continue our work toward achieving these goals.
Lynn, I read a quote from Carl Jung this morning who said, we've never really grown up until we're at least 40. Until then, we're doing research. We set a time each Sunday to share our sorrows and our joys. We know that sorrows shared are somehow easier to bear, and our joys shared are multiplied. So this morning we have some joys in the form of birthdays. And let's light a candle for these birthdays. Alan Hill, Pat Simon, Natalie Delville, Ed Devlin, Jean Brophy, Holland Shepherd, and Diane Sullivan. Those are the late July and early August birthdays. We wish you all a very happy birthday. And then I think Elizabeth Swope's birthday. Elizabeth Swope made the list here, so happy birthday, Elizabeth. And as always, it seems, here at UU, we have visitors. And let's have a candle lit for these visitors. Candace Blaylock from Oklahoma. You want to acknowledge where you are?
We have Mary from Paul's Valley, Oklahoma. Welcome. And Victor from Santa Fe. Welcome, Victor. And let's light one more candle for those shared, those joys and sorrows that we have not shared, but we carry in our hearts yet unspoken. And now let's sing Spirit of Life. It's in the hymnal, page 123. Dale.
Spirit of Life, come unto me, sing in my heart all the stirrings of compassion. Blow in the wind, rise in the sea, move in the hand, giving life the shape of justice. Roots hold me close, wings set me free. Spirit of life, come to me, come to me.
I invite you to share with me in this brief meditation. There'll be about a 1 minute silence after the invocation. In my body, I am at peace. In my mind, I am at peace. In my heart, I am at peace. In my soul, I am at peace. From the Venerable Thich Nhat Hanh, I have arrived. I am home, in the here, in the now. I am solid. I am free. In the ultimate, I dwell. So I was invited to share a short passage from my book. It's actually as the how the book ends. I call it the Universal Circle. My introduction to interspirituality began with a circle of strangers sharing a period of meditation. Our experience was beyond words. Now, years later, I begin each day with centering prayer as I visualize myself in a universal circle. I see myself sitting in a contemplative state with all my spiritual teachers and a host of global strangers from every world religion, from both contemporary and ancient spiritualities and belief systems. Each day as we enter the circle together, we follow the ancient tradition of taking off our shoes and also laying down our religions, races, national affiliation, ethnic identity, our religious, social, political prejudices, and thought forms, those preconceived ideas and mental constructs that underpin our everyday thinking. Then, free from all interferences or obstacles of our non-essential selves, we sit together, soul to soul, and allow the ever-present divine radiance, love, and consciousness to flow between us and envelop us as a community within humanity, silently dedicated to peace. Oneness is our future and our destiny. So I don't want to leave you today left with the trilemma, although it is a part of us because we're part of the human condition and humanity. I want to offer some hope in the direction that I call becoming universal spiritual persons. I have to say, but if you feel inclined in this direction, if you feel a latent desire that you haven't honored or explored, I have a few things on my bucket list that I'm trying to do now at 74. Because Barbara Marx Hubbard, who influenced me, said, it's a self-selected group of souls that go on this journey. I think it's probably the only way it can happen. Or maybe you're already on this path. So without patronizing you, I see Unitarians, I see Hindus, and members of the Baha'i faith as persons who have a good beginning already on this journey. I mention Hinduism not to set it above all others, but because it seems to exemplify a way of being in the world that I now embrace and will explain as transcending and including. Hinduism is 4 millennia old, has multiple systems and subsystems, but all have tolerated, or even better, allowed and valued and revered each other. They say true religion comprehends all religion, so that God is one, but humanity calls God by many names, as those kids taught us this morning. The top point of the trilemma on my handout is opened up the lower right-hand side of the trilemma can open if there was not just one definition of God, that lower right-hand corner. You know, the saving myth, the name of God, the one story that we all have to follow or should follow. On the left, that's where all the conflict takes place. Somebody calling somebody a heretic, somebody saying, you're not orthodox enough. And at the top, the struggle, which is perennial, I want the truth. No, I have the truth. You don't have it. Ken Wilber, who I like very much, says, we all have parts of the truth. That should free us all up a bit. There is hope, my friends. Even if we can get beyond our Western conditioned mind and our starting place, which, because we inherited, is dualism and separation as the foundation of everything. This is so unconscious, so subtle, that we're not aware of it day by day. We have to function and stay on in our lane, as they say. I don't want to be in the lane of oncoming traffic. So there's dualism in so much that we do. In Hinduism, there's a synthesis of life and all the ancient contemporary philosophies. But this synthesizing or integrated whole, Victor Nelson, my colleague, is here this morning, we're learning from our friend Rabbi J. Haman, is also part of Judaism. Let us make this one day, one of their rabbis prays, of exalting the source, the one who is at the heart of the many, the one who is all. So note well, this oneness is the foundation, some Paul Tillich called it, the ground of being. So different when you from starting with all the separate parts, you know, all the different religions, let me see, and get them together, I can get them to the parliament, or I can get them at the UN. It's very different if that's your mentality. I have to, maybe the foundation of unity is already there. I believe it is. And in that foundation, there's complementarity. There's mutuality, or as Dr. King would say, we're all interdependent. And as Thich Nhat Hanh says, there's interbeing. Very philosophical, but basically that this exists along with this. I exist here, you exist there, but in company with one another. In the Zen Buddhist tradition, Bernie Glassman, when he was with us, said, in Zen, there are two ways of describing reality. Reality is one and everything is Buddha. The other is the manyness of reality, its multitude of diverse phenomena and differences. Then I asked myself, Bernie, if he was still here, can these be reconciled? Yes, for Roshi Bernie and his Zen Buddhism, he said, for me, the practice has always been about one body. That was his starting point. Not just one body as a single entity, but also as a million billion different components, each of which is the one body. Some of you may recognize this as something that occurs in various images as scientists struggle. As I did, I put the image on the right hand, lower side of that page. Every one of these is limps, is not perfect, but the idea that where we live in a sphere, that the reality and the ultimate truth is on all sides of me, and it's flowing back and across and up and down, very different than the cosmology that we grew up with. So there's something else that's very helpful to maybe escape, if we could, from this collective unconsciousness, or at least the parts of it we want to flee. And that is seeing beyond all of the sameness and differences and recognizing that the whole, as Bernie is saying, and the parts, million billion parts, as he said, they are wholes and parts together. So that's what the current new physics or new subatomic physics is telling us. Now, some people say, well, it's still a theory, but relativity is still called a theory too. So maybe we have to live our way into it. Thomas Merton put it another way. He called it a hidden wholeness. The wholeness is there. It's in this community. It's in this body of people. It's in Santa Fe. But it's hidden. There is hope. There is much hope for us to become what Barbara Marx Hubbard called a homo universalis. We all know homo sapiens, knowing ourselves as a species who are conscious of ourselves and our thinking beings. Homo universalis is going even farther, developing our consciousness along with the source of consciousness and growing beyond what we thought we could ever be. As I said before, but I want to emphasize it because this is really the main dynamic in my book. It could be used all the way through when someone's reading. Transcending and including, Ken Wilber says. Transcending and including in the great chain of being. Maybe you've heard of that. Or, as he calls it, the enfolded universe. So the transcending and including is, it can be seen in a very simple way. Your own life. I was an infant. I became a child. On all levels, I'm growing and changing. I became a preteen. I became a teen. I became a young adult. I'm still growing. I'm changing. I'm not like the infant anymore, but a lot that was there with the infancy has come with me, has been included. Then I'm a middle-aged adult, and maybe now some of us are elders. So the example of this dynamic and this truth, I think, is very, very close to us. Wilber says it, I'm going to use a couple of quotes of him because he's so articulate. Each senior dimension envelops and enfolds its junior dimension. So the senior dimension is, you know, we don't know what we're going to be in 10 years in the world exactly as a human species. But it will envelop and include the junior dimension, and the two are combined. And that's why I like that image. At least it approaches the enfolded universe that we're talking about. Wilber calls it nest within nest within nest. My wife is always working with yarn at home. You know, sometimes it gets all tangled, and then this is the perfect example of what I'm speaking about. Everything is touching everything else, and they're not in separate parts as we used to imagine the world, but they're all enfolded with one another. And in a living universe, a living organ, this continues every day. As they say, the universe is expanding. So the other concept that I mentioned, but I didn't give it a name, and I should say to be clear, is a holon. So Wilbur points out that the world and the organic of the universe is hierarchical. Some things, and certainly we conceive of it this way, seem to be more important. You seem like you want to have a pastor or the head of an organization, or you need to have the vital organs, a heart, a liver, etc. But all those other functioning parts of your body are essential too. If one of them breaks down, we know what's happened. You're in the emergency room, you're in the hospital. Maybe you say your goodbyes. So a holon, this is another integral, I think spiritually helpful concept, is the whole in a part. And the best image of that is this. Just came across it yesterday, thank heaven. The Russian dolls, you've probably seen them. I know we can find them in the plaza. And there's two different kinds, so I'm just going to refer to the one because I can't pronounce the second one. One has a different little figure inside of it, designed differently. The other one has an older woman, a babushka. It's called the babushka Russian doll. And with one within, 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 and the small one is within, 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 within. It's such a beautiful illustration. So the world, according to Wilbur, is a holarchy as well as a hierarchy in this sense of what the new physics has taught us. The world is enfolded. Now, I obviously am interested in, I'm a student of this science, but I'm interested in the spirituality, and I leap forward with a great excitement. So what does this say? That's, you know, people say, well, it's all one. Well, I think you have to go farther in the articulation because you say, well, that's almost a cliche now. What does it really mean? So these are a few aspects of becoming a universal spiritual person. And I want to close with this by identifying this quickly. The one to begin with, I think, is John Denver, who has been a model for me in singing and in so many ways over the years, said at one point, I am a global citizen. He got it. He understood it. Sure, he began as an American, the son of an Air Force major, I think, in which your nationality, your race, your religion, your family origin, they stay part of you, but they take their proper place. Now they're secondary in some sense because you're looking at the whole world. And as John Denver said, it's one of my 10 inner spiritual principles that I recorded there. Give your love to everyone. It's not easy, but it's a foundation. The second one comes from Thomas Merton, who said, you're in a sense, as a universal spiritual person, related to everyone. Related to everyone. If you think of yourself that way, it's going to change the way you see all of the figures that are appearing on our screen at the Olympics. My sister just won the 100-meter dash with two Americans, one on her left and her right. But that was my sister, not just the runner from San Lucia. So what I discovered in the 1980s was that my belief system and my Roman Catholic identity and my role as representing that this particular church was separating me from the rest of humanity, and it began to break open my heart. I felt that it wasn't right. So another person who was both Catholic and Jewish, Simone Weil, some of you may have heard of her, she had a spiritual director, as I have had. It's a practice in Catholicism and other places, and he wanted her to be baptized. Simone said, no, this will separate me from my students. She was a philosophy teacher, and from her co-workers. She was working in a factory, and she didn't want that separation to take place. And she said, I'm standing at the intersection of all that is Christian and non-Christian, and from that vantage point, I will live my life. I love that, standing at the intersection, because this intersection keeps occurring over and over again. The universal spiritual person transcends the particular distinctives of his or her native religion and understands that you are free, this was the thesis of my book, to share in the wisdom and the traditions of all the other religions. At first I did it kind of in secret. I was reading Buddhism, but made sure my fellow friars didn't know I was reading it. I had to learn that I'm free to read this. I'm free to learn from this. I'm free to ingest this, to make it part of my life. So that's another aspect, and that is the thesis of my book. The easiest way to say that is to share in the wisdom, another collective word which is very good and very non-discriminatory, of all the religions, of the truth, wherever it appears. If it appears in that fire this morning, there it is. Universal spiritual persons honor, revere, and safeguard the divine in all of its manifestations in all beings. That was the practice of Thich Nhat Hanh and of some of my other mentors and teachers. And this comes first, or as a priority, before the comforts that one receives from your own tradition. In my history, I call it Catholic comfort. It's not bad. It's not bad. But certainly I can go beyond it. Finally, Merton said, and it's at the bottom of your handout there, we are already one, but we imagine that we are not, and what we have to do is recover our original unity. If, as a freely selected, voluntary, wannabe, universal, homo universalis, you move in that direction, this is one of the steps perhaps you will need to take, and I need to take, to begin with the foundation that it's already all one. And now, how do I live in that world, giving my love to everyone? And finally, the universal spiritual person freely and consciously transcends their previous stage of spiritual development and commits to cultivating their potential to be a homo universalis, a fully divine human being. This is who I am becoming. God isn't up there. He, she. This is who I am becoming, propelled by the fire of the Spirit. It was in the ritual this morning, and it is an exciting, spacious, spiritual adventure. I hope that you'll join me on that adventure.
And now I invite Leon Winston to come forward and give you some ideas of how you can help share that adventure.
Thank you, Sandy. As Sandy said, my name is Leon Winston. I'm a member of your Board of Trustees, and I'm here this morning to thank you for all you do and all you bring to this community, to this congregation, to this wonderful place where so much happens for so many people. And to ask you to be generous in your offering this morning. You know, you give in your time, you give in your treasure, and that really keeps this place going. And for all, all the wonderful things that happen here, all the recovery groups, all the lifelong learning, and our Sunday congregations and everything else. So we'll now pass the baskets. Thank you.
Well, like last week, our chalice has told us it's time to wrap things up. Our closing words today are from our gray hymnal. Take courage, friends. The way is often hard. The path is never clear. And the stakes are very high. Take courage, friends, for deep down there is another truth. You are not alone. Len?
You don't need the words of the song. It's from Dan Fogelberg. The chorus is two words, ever on. And you'll see how that fits with what I shared today and the possible potential direction for us in the future. There's three verses. Everyone, please sing along on the chorus. You can stand for it, and we'll meditate on the verses that Dan so wisely gave us. Thank you, Dan. May the trail rise up to meet you. May your heart rejoice in song. May the skies be fair above you. As you journey ever on, ever on, ever on, ever on, ever on, in this planetary circle, we are but a single stone, spinning on our fragile axis through the endless night alone. Steps as you lead us ever on, ever on, ever on, ever on, ever on, ever on.
Thank you. If you would take the hand of someone close to you and repeat after me. May love and skill be in our hands.
May love and skill be in our hands.
May love and courage fill our hearts.
May love and courage fill our hearts.
May love and wisdom light our minds. May love flow through us and walk among us.
May love flow through us and walk among us.
As we live our lives and work to heal our world.
As we live our lives and work to heal our world.
Amen, shalom, namaste, blessed be, assalamu alaikum, ashe, aho.